Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Rocket Monday. In today's episode, we're gonna take a look at NASA's one of the greatest missed opportunity. So let's get right into it. First thing you have to understand, it's a dream for any rocket company, any rocket manufacturer, or any kind of spaceship to be what's called SSTO. Basically, single stage to orbit. You don't have staging, you don't throw off pieces. You simply take off and you go to wherever you want to go in space, like we see in Star Wars, Firefly, things of this nature. This is the final goal that we want to achieve, and it has to be reusable. Like it can't be just like, you know, okay, we went there in one stage, it also has to come back and refuel and do it again. So these are the two goals. This is like the final holy grail. So if this is the final holy grail, why we are not doing it? Well, there is something known as rocket equation. Basically, for every amount of fuel you add, you kind of reduce the efficiency of that fuel by the fact that fuel is heavy. So let's say you have 10 ton fuel and you are like, okay, I'm gonna add 20 ton fuel. You're not gonna get twice the distance or twice the speed simply because your engine is carrying that extra weight. So for that reason, there has to be a very, very crucial and critical balance between these things. The only way as of now we can manage it is simply have specifically built engine with specific types of fuel that works very well in certain altitude, as in like kerosene and liquid oxygen in lower, and using hydrogen and oxygen in upper atmosphere. And engines are also specifically designed to maximize the yield, so that way we can bypass it, but to only to some extent. It's not like you can just keep making as many stages as you want. To some extent we bypass it. Second, staging is cheaper. Like SSTO, like physics is not telling you that you can't build SSTO, it's just that practicality of it is not there yet. Second, it's untested tech. So no one is rich enough, neither Elon Musk nor Jeff Bezos, no one is rich enough to test the kind of money needed to test these sort of thing. To give you an idea, what I'm referring to about NASA, they spent roughly around $1 billion on it, and that was just to make a 1/3 scale prototype, basically to test things, how things work and all that. $1 billion just to test out full scale would have costed a lot, and this was R&D money. This is not the money, like you might say, okay, Elon Musk has developed this engine, it is so unique and all that. No, it's not unique, it's simply old Russian engine design which they have optimized. And they have optimized because A, Russian engines are old, they used modern computer softwares and iterative upgrades to reach the performance where they are at right now. Same goes for Bezos also. All the engines that they are using, it's not new, it's not groundbreaking. To make something groundbreaking, it's completely different thing. It's like saying Apple invented the GPS. No, it's not. That's why no one is rich enough to do this. Then we come up to, you have to understand, NASA, once they made the Space Shuttle, it was very clear early on that it was a bad idea. Now, what I mean by that is that Department of Defense was also asking NASA to increase the payload capacity. But once the Space Shuttle was built, once they launched it, and once they have routine, as in space launches, they realized it was not going once a week, it was going barely two or three times to four times a year. So that was not enough frequency that military was looking for. Air Force wanted something that was very, very, very quick. Basically, if they wanted to launch, they wanted to do it in a week, not wait for next slot. So for that reason, the Air Force was flat out not satisfied, and they needed something that was quick and cheap to refurbish also. This thing, Space Shuttle, was not reusable to extent that people think. Now you might be like familiar with the fact that fuel tank was just thrown out. It was like, even though it landed on the sea, it was not recovered, like it was done. And the SRBs that was recovered, the amount of time and energy they put into rebuilding the SRB, it would have been cheaper to just directly buy a new SRB. So for that reason, flat out, even in the early years of Space Shuttle program, they realized the Space Shuttle is not gonna work out. So for that reason, Air Force wanted something different. So with private plus NASA, they come up with some idea. So the idea was what we call X-33. This idea was sold to NASA by the fact of Lockheed Martin, and the whole idea is very simple. They learned everything they needed to learn from Space Shuttle, and they were like, okay, what are the good things about Space Shuttle, what are the bad things? The good things about Space Shuttle is that it lands on runways. side effect, because of its lift ratio of its wings, it's not it cannot just land on any runway. It needs very long runways, as in like very long and very straight runway. The same issue is with Skylon, that you have to have something that is very long, very straight, and it's not very simple. It's not just that you can land it on any regional airport. So they improved on that and they built it. It's not like, you know, they just had the computer models to show for it. They built it. The 1/3 scale was built, and you might be like, okay, but that's not orbital class. That's absolutely true. But that's the only way you can test things out. Like, of course, there might be some unknowns. There might not be any unknown. So for that reason, they built the full scale engine, and 1/3 scale was almost built, as in like 90% of the part that is needed to build it was done, and 70% was of it assembled. Basically, to give you an idea, it was much farther along than James Webb Space Telescope is. So what happened? Basically, what they were trying to do is simple thing. It was, they wanted to see what aerospike engines can do. Basically, aerospike is simply replacing that bell with an inverted structure of the bell, which will look like a spike. So it has some pros, it has some cons. However, the crucial aspect of it is what's called altitude compensation. Basically, if it, as it goes up in the atmosphere, it does not lose the thrust that is producing because of the changing atmospheric pressure. So that was the first. Second, Space Shuttle is single stage to orbit. It, the engine that is light on the ground, like it keeps burning as till the point where it goes to the space. Basically, there is no things that it drops off. Now, what it drops off are what's called parallel staging. Basically, it's staging to just reduce, basically SRBs are reduced, and then fuel tank is jettisoned. So, but all things considered, but the engine still burns from sea level to space. So that's a single stage concept. So they wanted to refine that. So aerospike engine was a crucial fact for it. Second, they refined the design also in a such a way that the engine itself would be integrated to the craft in a such a way that it would not require gimbals. Gimbals are very expensive and crucial components, as in like they allow you to rotate the engines and all that. So saving mass saving from there, and the fact that aerospike engines have what's called much better mileage. In practical sense, they can save upwards of 30-40% fuel in lower atmosphere. So suffice to say, it's a very crucial thing. And the structure, the ship they built, was built on every mistake they did in Space Shuttle, like using ceramic heat tiles. They instead used metal based heat tiles. So the benefit of that is that even if it damaged, it does not go to, like, you know, 100% heat shield to zero heat shield. It goes from, it takes certain layer of damage before it gives out to, and they designed it such a way they can easily refurbish it very easily. So all the things they wanted to do, they did better in this. But why it was cancelled? Politics. Literally, even Air Force, as recent as 2012, they wanted to get this project back and, you know, restart this project. Because was this project, you know, one cure, one bullet to cure everything? No, of course not. Nothing can be. It had its own issues. However, all things considered, this would have teach humanity a few new tricks, specifically with heat shield, which right now Elon Musk can really use. And he also has to come up to the same point, how the heck he's gonna build the heat shield that's gonna handle the BFR re-entry. So for all that reason, we almost missed out a golden opportunity where we could have figured out aerospike engines, whether they work or not, or are they only good in paper, or they actually do something. Second, we would have learned out what are the logistics of single stage to orbit, and then quick and easy refurbishment that should have helped us to, you know, refine cost. All these things were lost simply because of politics. Now, I did made a video about why NASA sucks. You can check that here. Now, I'm very frank about this. I like NASA. However, the politics that is involved into it, it makes you like, dude, why? Why? Now, I do understand, because they are publicly funded, as in like public taxpayer money goes into it. So there would be some politics, but the management of that is really not good. So this was my presentation on NASA's greatest mistake. I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, please like. If you didn't, don't worry about it, dislike it, and leave a comment what you want to see in the next episode of Rocket Monday. And subscribe, press the bell icon, as I make video every day. And as always, thanks for watching.